Assalamualaikum. Today I will be teaching you about immunobullous blistering disorders, and in that I will be teaching you about basically pemphigus group of blistering disorders. This topic is very important from your exam point of view. Short essay questions come from it, and even MCQs can come from it. Okay. Now, what is pemphigus? Basically, it is a serious, acute or chronic bullous autoimmune disease of skin and mucous membranes, which is based on acantholysis. Now, what is acantholysis? Basically, you know the cells, that is the keratinocytes in the epidermis, they are joined together by certain junctions like desmosomes, and when there is some pathology going on, then these junctions, they break up and the cells are lying loose. This process is called acantholysis. Okay. Now, regarding the classification, there are two major types: pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigus foliaceus, and then paraneoplastic pemphigus, which is basically associated with underlying malignancies. Now, regarding the further subtypes of pemphigus, like pemphigus vulgaris has got localized and generalized types, then there is pemphigus vegetans, which is a localized type, and then drug induced. In case of pemphigus foliaceus, there is generalized pemphigus erythematosus, fogus salvagium, which is endemic, and again drug induced. Then regarding the epidemiology, pemphigus vulgaris is rare, more common in Jews and people of Mediterranean descent. Regarding the pemphigus foliaceus, it is also rare but endemic in rural areas in Brazil, where the prevalence can be as high as 3.4%. Age of onset is 40 to 60 years of age, but the endemic type of pemphigus foliaceus, that is fogus salvagium, it is also present in children and young adults. There is equal incidence in males and females. Regarding the etiology and pathogenesis, basically it is an autoimmune disorder, loss of the normal cell-to-cell adhesion in the epidermis, that is acantholysis, occurs as a result of circulating antibodies of the IgG class. These antibodies, they bind to desmoglyans, transmembrane glycoproteins in the desmosomes, which are members of the cadherin superfamily. In pemphigus vulgaris, basically the antigen, it is desmoglyan 3, but in some cases desmoglyan 1. Basically desmoglyan 3 is much more present in mucosa, and in skin desmoglyan 1 is more commonly found. All patients with pemphigus vulgaris, they have autoantibodies to desmoglyan 3. Those with mucocutaneous also have antibodies to desmoglyan 1. Those with only mucosan involvement, they have obviously got antibodies only to desmoglyan 3. In pemphigus foliaceus, patients have autoantibodies only to desmoglyan 1. These autoantibodies interfere with the calcium sensitive adhesion function, and thus they induce again acantholysis. Now, this is a slide which is showing in pemphigus foliaceus, you can see in skin there is more preponderance of desmoglyan 1, and in mucosa desmoglyan 3 is more important, more commonly found, and in pemphigus foliaceus skin is most commonly involved, that is desmoglyan 1. Okay, and in regarding the pemphigus vulgaris, desmoglyan 3 is most commonly the agent because it is more commonly found in mucosa, but skin can also be involved, so desmoglyan 1 and 3 both can be involved. Either only the desmoglyan 3 antigen can be involved, or both desmoglyan 1 and 3. Clinical manifestations in pemphigus vulgaris, this usually starts in the oral mucosa. Months may elapse before the skin lesions occur. Lesions, they may be localized for months, after which generalized bullae occur. Less frequently, there may be a generalized acute eruption of bullae from the beginning. No pruritus as occurs in pemphigoid, which is in another group of blistering disorders. Painful and tender mouth lesions, they may prevent the adequate food intake. Epistaxis, hoarseness and dysphagia can also be the symptoms which the patient can present to us, weakness, malaise and weight loss. Regarding the clinical manifestations in pemphigus foliaceus, no mucosal lesion and starts with scaly crusted lesions on an erythematous base, and initially it is present in the seborrheic area, but later on it can involve the whole of the body like pemphigus vulgaris. Now, regarding the skin lesions in pemphigus vulgaris, clinically the evolution of lesions is how They can present as round or oval vesicles and bullae with serous content, flaccid, flabby, easily ruptured and weeping lesions arising on the normal skin and randomly scattered and discrete, localized, for example, to the mouth or circumscribed skin area, or they can be generalized with the random pattern. Extensive erosions that bleed easily, crust particularly may be seen on the scalp. Since blisters rupture so easily, only erosions are seen in many patients and they are very painful. So the patient is basically in agony. Nikolsky sign, what it is basically dislodging of epidermis by lateral finger pressure in the vicinity of the lesions, which leads to an erosion. Pressure on bulla leads to lateral extension of blister. Basically Nikolsky sign, it shows the activity of the disease. When the patient is under treatment, Nikolsky sign won't be exhibited. Now, this is a picture which is showing how to demonstrate the Nikolsky sign. Dental traction on clinically unaffected mucosa may produce stripping of epithelium. This shows that there is, on the right side, you can see there is erosion is present now after the pressure which was applied with the thumb. So, this shows that this is a positive Nikolsky sign. Sites of predilection in pemphigus vulgaris, their scalp, face, chest, axilla, groin, umbilicus. In bedridden patients, the extensive involvement of the back may be seen. Mucous membranes, bullae, they are rarely seen as mucous membranes, they are trauma prone. Erosions of mouth and nose, pharynx, larynx and even vaginal mucosa may be involved. Now, this slide is showing the flaccid blister on the left side and you can see there is pus also accumulated in it and the area around it is erythematous. Initially it won't be, but later on it can be. On in the slide on the right side, the picture is showing erosion and there are some crusted lesions also seen. Erosions in oral mucosa, you can see the buccal mucosa is involved, and oral lesions will begin as the classic bulla. Shallow ulcers are seen as the bulla with the break rapidly. Erosions can be seen in any part of the oral cavity, even the gingiva may be involved. And when there is involvement of the larynx, they lead to subsequent hoarseness. In pemphigus foliaceus, the sites which are commonly involved, these are the seborrheic sites, which are face, scalp, upper chest and abdomen. Regarding the evolution of lesions, scaly crusted erosions on erythematous base in early or localized disease, sharply demarcated in the seborrheic areas, may stay localized for a long time or progress to generalized disease and even exfoliative erythroderma. Initial lesion also of flaccid bulla, but is rarely seen because of the superficial location of pemphigus foliaceus. This is a picture showing crusted papules and plaques which are involving the front of the chest. Vesicles are not seen here because it is a very superficial pemphigus. Now this is again picture which is showing crusted erythematous papules and plaques which are involving the neck and even the front of trunk. Regarding the variants of pemphigus vulgaris, pemphigus vegetans is the most common, usually confined to intertriginous regions, perioral area, neck and scalp, granulomatous vegetating purulent plaques that extend centrifugally. In these patients, basically, there is a granulomatous response to the autoimmune damage of pemphigus vulgaris. Now, you can see that there is maceration in the intertriginous area, that is the groin portion. And on the right side picture, you can see there are vegetative plaque involving the axillae. Then there is drug-induced pemphigus vulgaris. Different drugs are implicated. Most commonly, these are the captopril and penicillamine. Now, regarding the variants of pemphigus foliaceus, Brazilian pemphigus, which is not obviously here, present in Pakistan. It is an endemic type of pemphigus foliaceus, also known as Fogus salvagem. A distinctive form of pemphigus foliaceus, endemic to South Central Brazil. It is identical to pemphigus foliaceus. Patients improve when moved to urban areas but relapse after returning to endemic regions. And it is speculated that the disease is somehow related to an arthropod-borne infectious agent with clustering similar to that of the black fly, that is Similium incremenum. Now another variant is pemphigus erythematosus. It may have antinuclear antibodies as is the case in lupus erythematosus and its synonym is Sener-Usher syndrome. A localized variety of pemphigus foliaceus, which is largely confined to the seborrheic sites, erythematous, crusted and erosive lesions are seen in the butterfly area of the face, forehead, presternal and interscapular regions. These patients may have immunoglobulin and complement deposits at the dermal epidermal junction and in addition to the intercellular pemphigus antibody in the epidermis. And in these patients, even the antinuclear antibodies are positive, like lupus erythematosus. This is a picture which is showing the butterfly area of the face, and you can see there is erythematous, scaly and crusted plaque is present. So this presentation, in this picture you can put the DD as lupus erythematosus as well. This is the malar rash. Now another variant is drug induced. Similar drugs are involved in this case also, like d-penicillamine, and less frequently by captopril. And in most of the instances, the eruption resolves after the termination of the drug. Now another important is paraneoplastic pemphigus. It is not that common as like pemphigus vulgaris and foliaceus, and from your exam point of view, pemphigus vulgaris is much more important as compared to foliaceus and paraneoplastic. It is an autoimmune disorder stemming from an underlying tumor. It is hypothesized that antigens associated with the tumor that trigger an immune response, resulting in blistering of the skin and mucous membranes. Patients with malignant and benign tumors are both at risk, like thymoma and Castleman tumors. Malignancy is associated with high mortality rates. Regarding the pathogenesis, underlying tumor causes circulating and tissue-bound antibodies to direct themselves against antigens in the plakin family, which are involved in the intracellular attachment structures in various levels of skin, respiratory tract, membranes. The number of target antigens, it varies. Variability is likely what accounts for the different clinical presentations of this type of pemphigus. Target antigens, they can be desmoglein 1, desmoglein 3, the invoplakin, periplakin, desmoplakin and bullous pemphigoid antigens. Tumor production of plakin protein, it induces an autoimmune response. Regarding its signs and symptoms, mucous membranes primarily and most severely are involved. Lesions, they combine features of pemphigus vulgaris and erythema multiforme. Clinically and histologically, erythema multiforme can be caused by drug eruption or herpes simplex virus infection. The five clinical presentations of lesions, they can be like pemphigus, flaccid blister, pemphigoid, tense blisters, erythema multiforme like, that is severe polymorphic skin or mucous membrane lesions like targetoid lesions, graft versus host disease like, lichenoid eruption and lichen planus like, small red flat top, scaly papules. Mucous membrane lesions of oral cavity are presented first. They involve the oropharynx, nasopharynx, tongue and the vermilion border of the lips. They can also involve the mucosa of the eye. Cutaneous lesions tend to follow the onset of mucosal lesions. The blisters often erupt in waves. Sites commonly involve their upper trunk, head, neck and proximal extremities. This is the picture showing paraneoplastic pemphigus. The patient is in agony because the mucositis, which is caused by the paraneoplastic pemphigus, it is very, very painful. Crusted hemorrhagic crust can be hemorrhagic crusted plaques can be seen involving the nose and the perioral area, and there are also erythematous papules and plaques which are involving the body. Treatment focuses general wound healing. Administering the corticosteroids does not have a higher success rate, and the main treatment is to treat the underlying tumor. Now regarding the diagnosis of pemphigus, all kind of pemphigus, you can go ahead with skin biopsy. In case of pemphigus vulgaris, light microscopy, select small bulla or if not present, margin of larger bulla or even erosion. What you find is separation of keratinocytes suprabasally, leading to split just above the basal cell layer, and vesicles containing separated rounded up acantholytic keratinocytes. In regarding the pemphigus foliaceus, superficial form with the acantholysis in the granular layer of the epidermis. So the split in pemphigus vulgaris is just above this basal layer, so that is why it is called suprabasal, and in pemphigus foliaceus the split is in the granular layer. That is why when the patient presents to you with pemphigus foliaceus, you don't see any vesicles, you only see crusted erosions. And in pemphigus vulgaris you do see blisters, but they are only flaccid. Another important diagnostic method is immunopathology, direct immunofluorescence and indirect immunofluorescence. What do you do in this technique is that you basically detect the antigens by using fluorochrome tagged antibodies. By direct immunofluorescence, you can see the reveals IgG and C3 deposited in lesional and paralesional skin in the intercellular substance of the epidermis, which shows a fishnet appearance in case of pemphigus vulgaris. by indirect immunofluorescence serum autoantibodies IgG detected by it or enzyme linked immunosorbent assays. Titus usually correlates with activity of the disease process. In pemphigus vulgaris, the autoantibodies are directed against 130 KDA glycoprotein designated desmoglein 3 and located in desmosomes. In pemphigus foliaceus, the circulating autoantibodies, they are 160 KDA intercellular cell surface antigen desmoglein 1 in the desmosomes of the keratinocytes. Regarding the course of pemphigus, in most cases the disease progresses to death unless treated aggressively with immunosuppressive agents. The mortality rate has been markedly reduced since the treatment has become available. Morbidity related to glucocorticoids and immunosuppressive therapy is now currently seen. Regarding the management, glucocorticoids are the first line of treatment. It is given in high dose, 2 to 3 mg per kg body weight, until cessation of new blister formation and the disappearance of Nikolsky sign. Then rapid reduction to about half of the initial dose until the patient is almost clear, and followed by very slow tapering of dose to minimal effective maintenance dose. Then you have to start concomitant immunosuppressive therapy, which are also known as steroid sparing drugs. Azathioprine 2 to 3 mg per kg body weight until the complete clearing, tapering of dose to 1 mg per kg. And it is even continued even after cessation of glucocorticoid treatment and may have to be continued for many months or years. And then methotrexate either orally or intramuscular doses of 25 to 35 mg per week. Cyclophosphamide can be given in dose of 100 to 200 mg daily with reduction to maintenance doses of 50 to 100 mg per day. Or even you can give cyclophosphamide bolus therapy. Plasmapheresis in conjunction with glucocorticoids and immunosuppressive agents in poorly controlled patients. Gold therapy is not used most commonly, and mycophenolate mofetil 1 gram twice daily has been reported to be beneficial. Then you can give high dose intravenous immunoglobulins 2 gram per kg body weight every 3 to 4 weeks, but it is very expensive. And then there is monoclonal antibody to CD20, presumably targets the B cells, rituximab, given as intravenous therapy once a week for 4 weeks. It shows dramatic effects in some and at least partial remission in other patients, but they can be serious infections may be present in the patient because of that. Other measures, that is cleansing baths, wet dressings, topical intralesional corticosteroids, antimicrobial therapy per documented bacterial infections, correction of fluid and electrolyte imbalance. What is to be monitored? Clinical for improvement of skin lesions and development of drug-related side effects. Laboratory monitoring of pemphigus antibody titers for hematological and metabolic indicators of glucocorticoids or immunosuppressive-induced adverse effects, which is very important. Now, this is a short essay question, and then they are following 3 MCQs. Kindly attempt them and then email to me. These are the MCQs. Okay. Thank you.